Good morning. Good. I think it's still good morning for most of the people that are here.
I think so.
But wherever you are listening from or hanging out from, welcome to Creating the Future's third web strategy session. We'll do a quick go around of names and where we are located, and then dive in. I am Hilde Gottlieb with Creating the Future, and I'm in Tucson, Arizona.
I'm Dimitri Petropoulos, and since I'm sitting right next to Hilde, I'm with Creating the Future and in Tucson, Arizona. So.
Allison?
So my name is Allison Hewitt, and I am in Toronto, Canada.
And Annette is back, I see. Annette?
Yeah. Annette Sandberg, Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania. 41 degree Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania.
Which is nice.
Which is great.
Heat wave.
Yeah, just for you Tucsoners, that is really good. That's awesome. Mm-hmm.
That is just amazing. Yeah, wonderful, wonderful. Gail?
Gail Valeriot. I am with Creating the Future and also in Guelph, Ontario, Canada.
And Nancy?
Nancy Iannone with Creating the Future in Lake Havasu City, Arizona.
So I think you are farthest west today. Yay, you win the prize.
And it's going to be like almost 90 here today.
I know. God. I know, yeah. Well, and what's interesting when you live in the day is I was smiling, Annette, when you said that it was 41 degrees, because when I left the house this morning, it was 45 degrees. But it will be 85. So what happens in the desert is we lose heat and we gain heat so much that I sort of wore my fall jacket over here, and I'll be stripping by the end of the day.
That's good, because you get like full seasons of fashions that you can wear.
You do.
In one day.
Yeah, that's enough. Yeah.
We start the day with the heat on, we end the day with the air conditioning. So, yeah.
You guys think we feel sorry for you, don't you?
No, we don't in the least.
Not at all.
If you guys hadn't started talking temperature, we wouldn't have said anything.
I will say that Hilde is usually the first to say, don't say anything about the weather. Don't make people feel bad. Don't say anything about the weather.
Yeah, we talk about the weather in July when it's 110.
So. Yeah,
I was going to say we get our turn.
Yeah. It's our penance for having such a nice winter.
Exactly. Yeah. For anyone that is watching along with us, we would love to know if you're there. Please just tweet and let us know. The hashtag is CTFuture. And join in. Just dive into the conversation.
We'd like to know what the weather is where you are, by the way.
Exactly. Dive in, tell us what the weather is. Unless it's really nice, and then don't gloat. So, Creating the Future envisions a world where everyone is living well individually and collectively, bringing out the best in each other and in our communities. We know such a future is possible simply because it is not impossible. To accomplish that, our 10-year mission is to change the questions embedded in the day-to-day work of individuals and organizations so that everyone naturally brings out the best in each other and in our world. And I love starting the meetings with that. It just grounds us so, so beautifully. Because it is always... Oh, Carmen is coming. Carmen's here.
She is.
Yay. Oh, I'm so glad.
I don't need to call
her. Wonderful, wonderful. Are you're able to hear us?
Very well, thank you.
Oh, good, good. Just say your name and tell us where you are.
In Traverse City, Michigan.
Okay, you are breaking up, Carmen, so I'm going to have Dimitri give you a call, and if you guys can just make sure that her connection is okay. Is that...
Yes, and Carmen, I just tried to call your cell, and I also tried to call the phone, which I'm assuming is your office phone.
Yes.
Is the cell, which one should I give a call if I...
Or if you want to just call Dimitri.
Or you can call me.
Yeah, let me just call you, Dimitri.
Okay, and I had included my number in the note that I sent you.
Hold, stand by.
Okay, bye.
And is that Janet there?
It is. Good morning, everyone. Can you hear me?
We can indeed. It's wonderful, wonderful to see you. Just introduce yourself real quick and tell us where you are.
Sure. Hi, everybody. This is Janet Camarena. I am in San Francisco with the Foundation Center and the Glass Pockets Initiative, which is designed to champion greater philanthropic transparency.
wonderful, wonderful to have you here. We were just getting started, so...
I see Justin just pop in.
Did Justin just pop in?
That blank spot there is Justin.
Oh, well, welcome blank spot, that is Justin. I see now. Oh, I love these meetings.
Yes.
It's so interesting to have the online equivalent of people straggling in early in the morning. So it's sort of fun. We were just starting. I think she may be calling the office phone, so why don't you give that a shot? We were just starting to go around and just share what has been awesome for each of us in the past week or so to get us grounded here in what's going on. So whoever wants to start with what has been awesome for you in the past few days, whether it's personal, whether it's professional, just what's going on in your life that's making you smile?
I'll start. I've just come back from a three-week sojourn away from home in Nicaragua, and one of the things that I talked about yesterday at our board meeting was how amazing it was to be taking a Spanish language course, sort of a community-based Spanish language course, and really, really enjoyed the time and the experience of being in a community setting, doing practicing with people, you know, live time. That was really great. And yesterday, of course, we had our board meeting, which was our Creating the Future board meeting, which was really a wonderful conversation about what it means to be considering the concepts of diversity in real life. How will this organization ensure that we challenge ourselves, open ourselves at all times to as diverse a range of experience and perspectives as possible. Amazing conversation. I encourage people to have a look if you haven't had a chance to participate.
Yeah, it was pretty awesome.
Mm-hmm.
Awesome. Who else has something popping for them that's going on that's awesome for them?
I'll go. Oh,
go ahead.
I sold an image to National Geographic Education. Which is unexpectedly, they contacted me, which is very awesome. And I'm getting ready to go to Tucson for Creating the Future Immersion, so I'll be official, which is very cool.
Everybody's official.
Yeah, I'm playing, but I'm very excited.
So cool. Both of those are amazing. What was the image of?
One of the Knit the Bridge images. Yeah, crazy what's come out of that.
Oh, that is fabulous. If you guys haven't seen it, type in Knit the Bridge Pittsburgh. And Pittsburgh is a city of bridges. And Annette was part of a group that knitted quilts that just covered all of this one bridge. It was the most beautiful, beautiful thing we've ever seen. And we happened to be there for it. So definitely Knit the Bridge, Pittsburgh, just Google that and you'll find all of it. And Annette did phenomenal video and photos and, yeah.
That was fun. And there are over 2,000 volunteers involved with the project. Yep. Across all age groups. Oh, I could go on and on, but I won't. It was a very, very well thought out and effective project.
Yeah.
And pretty.
And I'm just going to share with you very, very quickly, Annette's awesome, is that one of her images of Knit the Bridge was is going to be published in National Geographic. National Geographic Education came to her and asked her for the image.
Woohoo!
So that was really cool.
Very, very awesome.
So with Carmen, we've decided that we're going to try it without her video image and see if that helps you do it. So.
Great. Wonderful. Can you hear us, Carmen?
I can.
Wonderful, wonderful. I'm glad you're here. Who else has got something going on that's awesome for them?
Over at Glass Pockets, we're in the process of launching a new project that's pretty exciting to overhaul our foundation transparency assessment and benchmarking tool. We've identified a consulting firm we're working with, and we're in the process of reviewing some exciting data visualizations that will feature trends in foundation transparency and make it easier for foundations to see what their peers are doing which, as we all know, peer pressure is great in philanthropy to spur, in this case, greater transparency. So we're really excited about that.
Oh, the stuff you guys are doing is so awesome.
It is. It is definitely.
Yeah. Wow.
Very cool.
Yeah, yeah. Love the stuff. If you guys aren't following Glass Pockets on Twitter and following the initiative, it's they've got great, great stuff going on. So.
And I thank Josh at Taproot for...
Jeff.
Is it Jeff?
Joel. There we go. Joel, something Joel, with Joel. A J. Okay, we've just totally publicly screwed that up.
Well, it's also, you know, I can claim old timers. But I thanking Joel for making the connection.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Who else has something going on? Mars always has something going on. That's awesome. Allison, what's going on with you?
A couple of things. I'm working on a really interesting intergenerational project. What I'm interested, I had a bit of a breakthrough yesterday talking to someone where we talked about the value of and the importance of thinking big, keeping the vision, acting big, thinking small, doing concrete kinds of actions. And so this morning I had an intergenerational meeting, and we sort of scoped out what we were all good at and what strengths we bring to the proposal and what we think that we can offer and what we want to learn from it. And in that, we were able to scope out those of us that will keep us big and those of us that will drive us to action. So the comfort in the ambiguity and the importance of driving to action. So with all those different roles, I feel we've got a very cool team working on this.
Wow. That so mirrors what our conversation was about composition of our board yesterday, talking about big thinkers and action thinkers. And
intergenerational.
Yep, exactly.
Importance of all of that. So yeah, so that was great.
It's really exciting. Really exciting what you guys are talking about doing. So, Nancy, Justin, Carmen, what do you got going that's been exciting for you?
Well, personally, I finished writing my midterms yesterday, so I'm done with that, which is good. Woohoo! I know. And I was watching the Web Strategy 2 session last night while I was knitting, and I kept having to stop to write notes and go, oh, that's really good. And then I'm like, oh, wait a minute, they can't hear me. And I had to quick send an email to the NPCon's tweet chat facilitators and send them the links and said, you really need to watch, listen, read the notes, because even though this is about web strategy, it's all about building community and creating safe space, places where people can connect in their vulnerabilities, and how does that apply to what we want to accomplish with the tweet chat. So I was bouncing up and down in my chair, even though none of you could see it because it was recorded.
Wow. I'm just thinking... We've already succeeded.
So, Nancy, you could see from that recording that we were being recorded and we were bouncing in our chairs?
Yes.
Yes,
every time somebody went, wow, I've got to make a note about that, or I just marked down the time. So I was like, yeah, exactly, I have that same note here. That was incredible.
Pretty cool and groovy. Carmen, what's been going on with you that is exciting? Tell us, it was hard to hear you before, so tell us where you are and where the connection is and a little bit about what's exciting in your life.
My name is Carmen Stevens, and I am with Haggerty in Traverse City, Michigan. And I am excited because we are in the middle of launching our campaign for global initiative here at Haggerty. So in the international footprint that we have, and I'm heading to Chicago at the end of the week to start some partner agreements and memorandums of understanding with the industry charitable foundation, the insurance industry charitable foundation, and a few other nonprofits we're looking into. It's a week-long campaign in October and will involve skilled service, pro bono engagement, hearts and hands volunteering, and of course, what we hope to be a hefty check to the beneficiary.
And for those who are not familiar with Hagerty, Hagerty is, and correct me if I'm wrong, Carmen, but Hagerty is the largest insurer of antique classic cars in the world.
Oh, my.
Yes, we are. We're the largest, call them collector vehicles, and it includes boats, too, those beautiful wooden boats that were handmade and they're still surviving, and so... Yeah, it's a busy week here. If you're into classic cars, it's the Amelia Concours d'Elegance in Amelia Island, Florida. It's the first of the season, and we have a lot of folks gearing up to get not only some warmer weather in the south, but look at some beautiful cars.
Wow. So Jay Leno is a big client of yours?
I'm sorry?
So Jay Leno is a big client of yours?
Like, confirm or deny that, but I know you've probably seen him on stage. With our logo wear, so I think perhaps you already understand where we're at with the MDA. So
I feel like
Oliver North right now.
That's great. The plausible deniability, I can't say. Neither confirm nor deny that. That's great. That's great. And Carmen heads their CSR at Hagerty, and we met when I was in Michigan, so it's pretty exciting. Justin, are you there?
Yes, I am. Can people hear me?
Yes, we can.
Yes. Yep.
Okay. My awesome right now is really simple because I'm totally crazy. My awesome is technology that allows me to walk my dog and listen to this call right now and participate. I think the only other thing that I would like to add, which perhaps is a segue, but also in response to Nancy sharing about that last session, I think, you know, engagement is so critical to all of what the work is that's going on, I think, for most of us. And I thought, just as Nancy, not that I haven't thought of it before, but as Nancy was talking about, a website is an engagement tool. It's about engagement. That's the whole purpose of it. It was like, oh yeah, duh. So that's it for me.
That's pretty awesome. That's pretty awesome. We've had meetings also where Annette has been driving down the freeway and the iPhone is sitting on the dashboard. So the technology is pretty.
And Gail has done the same thing.
Gail has done.
Yes. Yes.
Pretty amazing. Let me share with you guys the thought process that we've been using for this conversation, and as has already been bubbling out, and if you've read the notes, it's very clear that a website is just technology, and it is technology towards what end, and the towards what end is people. So much of the focus over the past two meetings has already been that it's about the people. It's not about the thing, it's about the people. The thought framework that we're using in these conversations is our catalytic thought framework that starts with the biggest picture possible of what is possible, what can this website make possible towards our mission, which we talked about in meeting number one, and then starts to walk backwards to create a chain of causality. So that our actions we know are going to be aligned with the conditions that we want to create towards that end potential, because our greatest power is in creating conditions that create the end result. So one of the things that we found in our own work is people tend to start web strategy conversations how much money do we have, what do we want the tech to do, what are the various ideas that we have, and we all tend to start most of our conversations, regardless of if it's web strategy or not, in the doing, in the stuff, and in the how. And what we have found is that no matter where a conversation starts, it always gets narrower and always gets smaller, always gets into more details. And so the higher we can start the conversation, the more likely that we are, as we move down into actions, to create actions that will actually cause some pretty catalytic results. And as you guys have all, several of you have already mentioned, what we've been talking about in the past couple of meetings is some pretty catalytic results, which is pretty awesome. What we've done so far is we've identified who our audiences are, and one of the big things, because it is about the people, never about the thing, is to identify really explicitly that there's two audiences. There's the audience that we very, very much want to reach in terms of accomplishing creating the Futures mission. And as I read, we have a 10-year mission to change the questions embedded in the day-to-day work of individuals and organizations. For us, the most important audience for that is influencers. So whether that is somebody in a position like yours, Carmen, where you're in a corporation that has many different arms and can influence change in a whole system, whether it is a capacity builder, whether that is in the community benefit or the for-profit world, whether that is a funder, investor, social investor, those are influencers that can influence systems. That's our primary audience that we want to reach to achieve our goal. However, there is, and I don't mean primary, secondary as in importance, I just mean in terms of there's two. The second audience is those people who are drawn to this work. People who are on the ground, social entrepreneurs, community benefit organizations of all kinds, small businesses, and influencing them matters as well, and giving them a place to be matters as well. And so as we've been talking, we've been sort of moving back and forth between those two types of audiences. Pardon me. And just starting by asking the question, what can a website make possible for all of them? And then as we've been talking last time, and we'll be talking again this time, we've identified the reasons those people would come to the site. And now starting to look at, okay, what are the conditions that need to be in place for them to get what they want out of that site? And mostly coming from the place of, what do they need to feel when they get there? What do they need to see? What do they need to immediately experience to say, oh, okay, this is where I want to be, and this is how I can find things? and you'll see in the notes from last time as we started to talk about some of the things that they're going to be looking for is timely information that is curated. They're going to be looking for an easy on-ramp, language that meets them where they are, and we talked a lot about the fact that that the website or any activity would need to be built about around the relationships because it's about the people. We began early on, we wound up listing the reasons people would come to the site. What would they be looking for? And if you have the notes that we posted, I'm sorry, just yesterday, because doing the notes for that second meeting was that's a bit of a job. We noted that people are going to be looking to learn, to teach, to practice, to connect, to explore, to share what they're learning, to visualize what's possible, to contribute, and also to track our progress as creating the future to see, you know, how are they doing? I'm curious. I'm sort of following along the story. And what we focused on last time was what would people be looking for in a site if they were coming to learn? What would they be looking for if they were coming to connect and to contribute? And so what we're going to focus on today is the rest of the reasons that people are coming. And so that is to teach, to practice, to explore, to share, et cetera. And so that's where we're at process-wise. Everybody ready to go? Are there any questions?
I just wanted to add, there is one sort of like subgroup within the second group that you're talking about, and that's people who are not affiliated with anything and are just sort of interested in this from their own personal life.
Individuals.
And we actually have individual supporters of Creating the Future who aren't with any affiliated with anything but really believe in the work that's going on. So that's also
And it's meaningful for their lives.
Yes.
Absolutely.
Are there any commonalities among those individuals? Do they tend to be founders or pre-founders, formerly affiliated?
It's sometimes people, Janet, that this work just resonates with them as an individual in the way they be in their life. They want the world to be a better place. They sense what is possible. When I wrote the Pollyanna Principles 6 years ago, 7 years ago now, I had somebody, and the Pollyanna Principles is written entirely to the community benefit sector, is entirely focused on transforming nonprofits. And I had somebody say to me, this is not a book about nonprofits. This is a spiritual work in the guise of a manual for nonprofits. And that is how many people recognize it. It resonates. There's something about the work we're doing that resonates with them deeply spiritually, and they're not affiliated with anything, or nor do they intend to be. And many of them follow us on Facebook, on Twitter. They're actively following us on Twitter. They tweet to us on Twitter. And they may be an artist. They may be somebody who, works in an accounting firm and writes poetry at night. I mean, it's just, yeah.
Okay, so there's
an accounting firm and doesn't write poetry at night.
Oh, darn, not them.
Yeah. So it's great. It's great.
Hildy, would you be able to just quickly walk through what the agenda or what are the key questions we are going to be considering today for the sake of being able to follow what's coming up?
Absolutely. With the remaining things that people would be looking for in the site, we're going to be asking the question, what do people need to feel, see, experience when they arrive at the site? So this is all about them and not about what does the site need to do, but what do they need to feel, what do they need to experience, what do they need to see if they come to practice, if they come to explore, if they come to visualize what's possible, etc. What do they need to immediately identify, oh yeah, okay. This is where I want to be.
I have a quick point of feedback. Having listened to, I was here for the first session and missed the last one. I had, there are many people who kind of hover and don't participate, but they're listening. They're, people who may not be comfortable jumping in. And one of my friends, former colleagues, was one of those. And after the first session, she said, it was really energizing and exciting, but I only understood about 50% of what they were talking about. And this is a high-level management person. And after the last session, you guys changed everything around, including if you used any language that was outside the norm, you defined it. I thought that was just amazing how quickly that became accessible. I admire that so much. So, yeah.
Yeah, it is an interesting thing about this process. It really gets to, and because it is a creative process versus a reactive process, we're constantly asking the question of what conditions need to be in place to accomplish what we need to accomplish. And those things that would otherwise be seen as challenges, obstacles, problems become just conditions that need to be put in place. So thank you for that, Annette. It's affirming.
And exciting.
And you're going to be here learning to practice that every single day of your life, so that's pretty cool. Why don't we dive in with that? Why don't we dive in with one of the things that people will be coming to the site for is to practice a different way of being and asking questions in their day-to-day. They will be coming, whether they are influencers within a... if it helps you to identify with your own... where you come from. So if you're a consultant that is coming on how to practice, if you are in a corporation and you're thinking, okay, how can I practice changing the questions in my own corporation? If you are in the foundation world, how can foundations change? How can I change my practice? Because practice is a very individual thing. Sometimes people are coming for a group thing. To learn might be, I want to learn, but I want my team to learn. But practice is an individual thing. What do people need to feel or see or experience at the site if they're there to practice?
So, Hildy, this is Carmen. Can everyone hear me?
We can.
I wasn't able to make the first two, but you know, for me, it's about the energy that you feel on the site, and so many sites are stagnant in that if I'm coming to practice and I'm coming to, you know, formulate a new way to approach or socialize a concept internally or externally to my organization, it's not something that's natural to me yet, and I want it to be natural, so every time I go back to the site, I want to have the ability to feel like, oh, this is a great new practice for me to start. And also, who can I reach out to talk to about that particular practice? Mm-hmm. So I feel like the energy and the action around what we put on the site is going to be really important to generate the behavior that we're looking for to support the mission.
Mm-hmm. Let's talk a little bit about energy. What does it look like? What does it feel like?
From my perspective, it's welcoming, but it's also it's inspiring. So the energy that I would like to see there is a commonality with the discussion and the terms and the people who are providing their sources of information, but also kind of buoy effect of, okay, we know that some of these conversations are going to receive pushback initially, and that can be defeating to some people, and that might be all they need to not move forward. But if they have something to reach out to and to connect with that says, you know, this is the next step, this is what you do, these are the challenges I also faced, it's going to build their kind of awareness of the issues and also keep them coming back to learn more.
Mm-hmm. What a wonderful start. What does that feeling of energy feel like to the rest of you guys? What would indicators be of that energy?
Well, I think when you get to the front page, it's going to be important to have portals to different categories that are very simple and basic, so that it's like, here's this, and to go deeper, go here. I think having too much on the front page becomes overwhelming. And so people come and they clearly see, and the front page is designed in a way that is appealing and energetic, and you already have a lovely logo to help with that. But I also think it's important to build on what Carmen was saying. People engage in different ways, and depending on their personality, their first level of engagement may be reading what everyone's written. If there's a form or whatever. That may be, and it may take them a while before they even participate there. Where some people are going to, you know, they'll pick up the web version of picking up a phone. How do we appeal to all of those in a way that's right, appealing? Yeah.
We just went through this process with the Glass Pockets website because we redesigned it last year. And I think we went through what you're describing, where one of our favorite descriptions of what not to do is a Manhattan closet. It's where New York, headquarters in New York, that makes sense to a lot of people, but the idea that everything looks presentable until you open the closet because they're so storage starved, stuff falls out. And we suffer from that sometimes at Foundation Center because we have so much data to share, that suddenly we stuff things in corners and it just really turns people off. So the goal with Glass Pockets was to create a really clean, inviting energy that didn't overwhelm people. So I'm hearing a lot of deja vu as you're talking through this. And the thing that really motivated us was the idea of having a clear call to action, because we found that a lot of the data we were originally pushing at people was in the hopes that it would encourage certain behavior. So now we start from the behavior that we want them to do and create these calls to action on the homepage, so that when people land on the page, there's kind of a somewhat of a clear path, although there's, I wouldn't call it clutter. We're trying to also grab people, like you say, based on personality. For the person that's not, bless you. So for the person that's not ready to be called to act, there are some things that can more passively read to become informed. But the whole first part of the page that greets you is about, you know, what behavior we want to see changed in the world. And then down below is things, if you're not sold on being brought into ACT, you know, data to kind of support that those actions, and that in the form of blogs and tweets that are fed to the page, and just some compelling statistics.
Gotcha.
This is Justin. When I was thinking about the energy and, you know, the whole idea of it's about questions, and so mm-hmm. for me that energy is curiosity. Mm-hmm. What are we doing that's piquing curiosity? You know, and I almost thought as Annette was talking about sort of the front page, I was like, I want to, you know, part of this is presenting the power of a question to mm-hmm. get people different. And, you know, it's like, imagine landing on this page, and to use our own framework, you know, what were you hoping coming here would make possible for you? Mm-hmm. You know, to just sort of mm-hmm. reframe that that whole thing of, you know, a lot of what we're doing is figuring out why people would be here, but part of our methodology is they should be asking why they're there. and mm-hmm. so that energy in it of kind of using their own curiosity and piquing it through our sort of frame, so that, you know, going back to sort of those initial thoughts that where people were talking about of that energy of, oh, this is what it's like. This is what it's like to experience this thing when you talk about changing the question or using questions. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. I really love that approach. You know, the good thing that caught my attention in the notes was from the last meeting was that discussion around the Google approach where, you know, question be our home screen. And then your answer, when you type it in, is connected to the portals.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So you're actually achieving both. You're calling out curiosity, but you're also calling out that call to action.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
The other thing I think that's important to note is I think a lot of organizations spend a lot of intellectual capital focusing on the homepage, and the behavior I know I've observed in myself and in others is when I go to a website I don't know, the first thing I click on is about. Mm-hmm. And about is sometimes an afterthought with mm-hmm. no there there, and yep. then it turns me off and I leave. Mm-hmm. If I feel like I don't know, if not a lot of energy has been spent, you know, making that about substantive, I just find it snake oil almost. And so, you know, I become immediately suspicious. And part of it is my transparency bent, but I know I'm among people who share that. So I would focus a lot on the about if I were you, because some people just won't get it, and they'll go to about and they'll want some sort of explanation or orientation or kind of establishing shot, if you will, to help them understand what's going on.
The sense that I'm getting is because I know that for me, I'm with you, that wherever I come into a site, I go to the about. And I rarely come into a site from the homepage.
Right.
It is linked to a blog. If I'm in Twitter, if I'm in Facebook, it is something that is, and from there I'll go to the about, and I may never get to the homepage. And so I think that part of what we're talking about is whatever essence we think people need to feel, they need to feel it everywhere. They need mm-hmm. to feel it on every mm-hmm. blog post. They need to feel it absolutely everywhere. And it's not just from content. It's from the stuff. So what is that stuff that infuses, because I really love that sense of energy.
There's a dynamic. Kims.
What does it look like? What does it feel mm-hmm. like when you get to, whether it's a blog or whatever, go.
I was going
to
say, there's a what I'm envisioning is something that's very dynamic. So wherever you go, and this is what triggered it for me, wherever you enter this site, it can mold to you based on your curiosity, based on your questions, based on what you're looking for. So the homepage, it may take you to the homepage at that point based on what you ask for or not. And based on what your curiosity is or not, but that it becomes more, you know, the structure of websites is, so like so many things, a function of the technology that it evolved from. So the idea of a homepage was, I mean, you know, this was hypertext, and it was, you went to a page like in a notebook, and this has the ability to be much more than that. And I'm trying to think about it from an energy standpoint. How do you do that in a way that accommodates the person who arrives there, so that they feel that it is talking to them and responding to them based on who they are. So maybe it ends up on your question to a whole different homepage. You know, it rearranges itself around who you are or what you're looking for.
I think that's great. I also think when I get there, I want to know I found my people. Like, I want a sense of belonging, and so pictures of real people as opposed to, you know, other kinds of imagery, I think, would be wonderful. I really want to have an opportunity to engage, and so it's got to be as interactive as possible. And so what does that feel like? One of the things I think we might do if we're thinking about some homework for this group is, what are some sites that do the kind of things that we really like? You know, if we think of these kind of elements that we're talking about, belonging and engagement and not overwhelming us and creating a sense of community, et cetera, are there any sites that we know that maybe haven't got all of that but have got parts of it? And we could begin to collect a bit of a wiki or a Google Doc or something that captures those kind of things. I think that would be wonderful. And also, it gives a sense that this is a group that's very thoughtful and dedicated to move to action. And I think that is clearly what this group is, and we need to figure out ways to communicate that. So you're in with a group of people who are thinking about these things and yet are driven to create the future, as an example. And unfortunately, I have to go, but I just thank you for the chance to contribute again, and I will follow with you guys in a bunch of other stuff.
We're going to loop in next time. Thank you, Allison.
Thank you, Allison.
Thanks, Allison.
Bye.
I've been very struck by that. I actually had curiosity written down, too, before Justin brought it up. When we talk about the feel of the website, I keep envisioning someone with their hand out saying, come on in, come on in. And since I'm a book geek, I envision like a big library that has cozy corners that I can curl up and just explore. Or I can come in and get the book I need and leave. I just, that feeling of welcome, and that I can, and you talked about it a lot in the last session about meeting people where they are, whatever it is they need at that moment, and what are the questions that would help them find that. And I love that part of it, because that curiosity, feeding that curiosity and having a space where you can explore without having somebody shove something in your face. You know, because my least favorite websites are the ones that I go, ooh, this looks really cool, and then something comes up in my face going, and give us your information right now, which I know is a very popular technique, but if someone's trying to pull me in to explore, I'm like, yeah, I'm out of here, I'm gone.
Ditto.
I want to be able to, it's like when you went to Powell's, Hildy. I want to be able to wander around and explore where I want to. And if I want to click on the button that says, do you need more information? That's great. But I don't want somebody popping up and saying, would you like to talk more? No, go away and leave me alone. Right now, I'll let you know when I do. So how do you make it welcoming and have those opportunities to connect, but also have it so people can wind around the stacks and find what they're looking for, because they don't always know, as you talked about in the last meeting, and go, ooh, I never saw that before.
You know, Nancy, I have encountered that same kind of pop-up that you're describing, where it will not let you do anything right. until you answer it. I mean, there's some right. that just let you click it off and move on, and that's okay. I like it less, but it's the ones that just say, no, you can't have any information unless you do
to
this.
To me, that speaks to the opposite of what we're about. Yeah. Speaks to a lack of authenticity. It mm-hmm. speaks to we have wonderful content and we really want you to explore, but what we really want is to put our hands in your wallet. Right. So if you could just explore long enough that we could stick our hands in your wallet, then we'll be happy. Or we want right. your email address. Or we want
it's a very retail model.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, mm-hmm. yeah, and it's used unfortunately in so much of the community benefit world. Ms. Valeria.
It is.
When I think about the question that you asked us about practicing a different way of being in their day-to-day life, the first thing I thought of was how people would probably want to feel safe actually doing that, allowing themselves mm-hmm. to be seen practicing or experiencing the act of practicing, which of course can really turn your life upside down when you're trying to do something new. So it strikes me that feeling safe might include, or at least not alone, mm-hmm. might include examples of other people, maybe stories of other people and what they're doing, how they're practicing differently, what sorts of risks they're taking, what sort of experiences they're having because they've been trying mm-hmm. something different. And it makes me think about one of the best community organizers I've ever known was a person who worked really hard to stay out of formal spaces. And the way she organized her first, no, it wasn't her first, but anyway, really cool tool. She had a car, and she was doing community-based work. She had a car and a whole bunch of lawn chairs in her trunk. And her approach was to simply pull up to wherever she was going to be, put the lawn chairs out, sit down, and wait to see who came forward. And so... And brilliant, brilliant work was done sitting around drinking a cup of coffee because, of course, then it allowed for whoever's front lawn you were sitting on to be the person who offered the hospitality of the cup of coffee. And it also allowed people to informally gather to choose to be there because there was something actually of interest to them rather than them being studied or polled or... you know, in any way the object of scrutiny, but it asked them for their brilliance and to demonstrate, to share that instead of kind of being told, this is how we do this and you will learn. So what would I see,
what would I feel, what would I experience when I get to the site? What would I see?
I guess there would be someone there convening. There would be someone, ready to go, even if it's at a scheduled time. There would be, so we're so good at using Google Hangouts, Hangouts that allow people to choose to pull up their lawn chair mm-hmm. for conversation, for exploration, for practice together, with a stated aim of sharing stories or examples.
I'm so glad you brought this example up, Gail. This is a wonderful example, and it touches on something that I was thinking about, but I was thinking about how to do this in a way that isn't the retail model. Mm-hmm. So often you go to a website, and that little window pops up and says, hi, can I answer your questions? Can mm-hmm. I do whatever? And you know that they just want to sell you something. But it is that idea of that there's a real interaction that can happen at that point. Mm-hmm. Great engagement. So I think figuring out how to do that would be extremely powerful in making it a real-time site that has energy.
With real people.
With real people.
Yeah, right.
With real people, a real-time site, that's really happening, and then that still has all the other informational New York closet stuff everywhere. But mm-hmm. how you are welcomed in, that makes the difference. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Well, one of the things I really liked about the summary you sent out was that you had quotes from what people had said, you know, about the aha moments. And right away when I was reading those, I thought, oh, that would be cool. Like on the front page, you have little, you know, talk bubbles with from the last webinar. These were some of the aha moments. You know, just kind of pull people in and say, oh, wow, that's really cool.
Oh, the energy and the aha. I mean, I just circled that in red. My red pen is out.
Yeah, because you're already doing some of that. It's just about how do we make it, how do we make it a little more obvious? And, you know, and use design to present it.
And responsive to a variety of learning styles, because you know, many people, myself included, don't have the attention span to read a lot, and certainly the scrolling down experience. I shared your excitement about the ahas and thought, oh, good, this is the stuff I really want to know.
Yeah.
And
And that could pull people into the hangouts, because if they see what people are talking about and get a sense of the feel in one of those hangouts, that might make them feel like, oh, I would really love to see what they're saying today or in the next whatever's coming up.
Yeah.
And that ties in. Go ahead, Carmen.
Well, I would
Carmen then Nancy.
Kind of turn our, you know, give another perspective. I really like that bring your lawn chair approach. And from my experience building intranet sites and intranet sites, they are something that is never stagnant. And I wonder if we don't provide some kind of outward in perspective from our folks, where they're actually making the website as they grow with us, if that makes any sense. So, they're actually seeing the website shift and move and create new spaces as their needs kind of bubble. That would be a really great, like, I would be amazed by that. I know it's a lot of time, but it can be done simplistically in certain senses.
Do you have experience with that? It's something that you can share what that looks like?
Yeah, so our intranet is completely internally based, obviously, but it's based on the needs of our staff and our kind of our place to gather information. And in a corporation, as many of you know, there's so much to be found that even the, you know, the search functionality doesn't quite get what you want. And so we periodically listen virtually, we, you know, chart the path behind the scenes to see, you know, the heat maps that are going on, where people are trying to find their information, where they leave a page, and then we change the, you know, the way that people access that. And we have a, you know, even have a demo site in place for a little while with a certain focus group. You could give them a separate URL if you wanted to do that and see how that resonates. And we do it twice a year. So it doesn't have to be an everyday thing, but it's there's an interesting concept in that for me where it's like it's really community driven. The community that we're trying to engage is really a part of this movement.
Wow.
So maybe the question isn't how do we do this, but what would it take for us to do this? We may have to design something that we haven't seen before.
And we'll get there.
Yeah.
The how never bothers me. We'll figure out the how. Nancy, you had something as well, because I'm like, my brain's just gone.
The aha moments really ties in with what I was feeling about welcoming, because it draws people in. These are real people talking, so in a sense it's inviting you in to be part of the conversation if there's something there that resonates with you. And I was looking at, like, at Jane's comment yesterday or from the last meeting about you know, her music community, who say, I found my people. Well, how many of the people that we've met through Creating the Future have said that same thing? I found my people. Well, even seeing that as an aha moment from that last discussion would be, wow, these are people that are talking about this. I want to find out more about this. If it resonates with you, it's going to draw you in. to find out more without somebody saying, come find out more. It's organically going to draw people in like someone's having a conversation.
Yeah, the word that comes to mind as you're describing that, Nancy, is authenticity. It has it's full of energy, but it's also authentic. And I think, Carmen, what you were describing is, the example that you were giving is, that's an authentic response to what people are doing, as opposed to, this is the information we want you to have. No, what information do you want to have? And we're going to make this be that for you, and that change, then I have ownership in this. As you know, one of the employees, and I really am always looking for X, and look, they changed the site, so X pops up when I first get to it. This is me. How did they know? Yeah. Exactly.
And Carmen, I just need to share with you that I wrote down the timestamp of when you were talking so that I can go back and, like, jot it all down.
Oh, thank you.
One of the things that is occurring to me in this conversation that came up in the last conversation as well is that I think many sites use placeholder language for what they really want rather than be explicit. And what I'm sensing here is again the conversation that we had last time that you know I jotted down. Let me grab it real quick. Troy basically saying, where are you? Be explicit to say, we're here. This is what we're doing. We feel exactly what you're feeling. We know what you're doing. We know where you're stumbling. And I think that in many cases, we as in the world, in websites, try to sort of say, assume we know what you're looking for and make the three-step leap and go, here's the answer, rather than saying, hey, you got this question? We've got this question too. And I'm really sensing in everything that you guys are talking about the need to be explicit with what people are feeling and what they're looking for, rather than are making the assumption that we have an answer, that it's from their perspective rather than, I'm not making sense, but...
Mm-hmm. Yes, you are, and it makes complete sense. And it speaks to the thought framework, the approach that we take, which is never about telling people what the answer is, but always sharing the journey of the questions.
Yeah, and it does make sense, because one of the things, I think it was Robert who said something about, we all come to this because we're experiencing pain somewhere or feeling alone in wanting things to be different.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And so being real about, that it's not, Pollyanna, I love that. And being also real that, this is really hard for a lot of people, and this is a safe place to talk in a real way. We're not going to say, we don't talk about that negativity here. I mean, of course, we're going to frame and have different conversations, but being genuine about that, this is, it's okay to have these questions here, and we have faith that together we can do this. We can move towards a better tomorrow. We can create the future differently together.
Beautiful.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, the language piece is growing in my mind right now, that it's not about just words, but about what we say, which I know sounds absurd, but what are the actual words on the page? It's not language like, this word means something different to these people versus these people, but it's actually the text, the content of what we say and how we say it in every place.
Mm-hmm. Just as a quick aside, when we developed the tagline, change the questions, change the world, the principles didn't change, the work, that the intention of the work didn't change, but the way people perceived it changed. And all of a sudden, there was a clarity from those, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 words of, that's what you guys are doing, as opposed to the 20-minute elevator speech trying to explain what we're trying to do. So I agree, Hildy, that I think is very powerful, the specific words, the intent of the specific words.
And the language overall. What right. else, if I'm coming to practice, if I am, I've played around with this stuff a little bit, I've read something, and I could be reading it on Facebook, I could be reading it wherever, Or I read the article that was in Stanford Social Innovation Review, and I'm playing around with this. Very much, I think, Janet, the place of practice is a place where you guys are at, because people are putting their toe into a new way of being. If I'm looking to find ways to both advance my own practice in this and learn from others who are practicing, what might I be looking for? What do I need to see and feel and experience when I get to the site to say, oh, yeah, okay.
It's kind of like flow in a building. You don't want to have to think about where to go next. There should be some natural flow that guides you. And that's what the principle of our web redesign was based on, that because the feedback we got from our initial site is they would take the assessment but then not really understand what comes next. Mm-hmm. So one of the first things we did with the redesign was create the steps to transparency. So I think you need something like stepping stones or milestones to creating the future. So there's somewhat of a path laid out so people don't have to feel like, okay, I can check this off my list.
Process.
And also have examples. I think it's important because you say, change the question, change the world. Well, what's the example of a question? What do you mean?
Right.
Yeah. You know? I think that's going to be very important. So you answer the questions about the questions.
like peer ambassadors of some kind.
I'm
also thinking about, and Annette, I'm sorry, I missed a meeting this morning of the group of consultants who are in Pennsylvania who are hoping to do some things in a different way as a group. Sorry, different context. I meant Justin.
Always confuse Annette and Justin.
All the time.
They look so alike, yes.
I beg for your forgiveness for
Here's
my
Here's what I look like. See?
See, they do look exactly alike.
Oh, gosh.
Yeah, it's eyebrows.
It's not enough coffee. Anyway, there's a group of people who are consultants to community benefit organizations who are actively asking the questions we're talking about right now. What does it mean to take a different approach to your practice where you start with community outcomes rather than organizational whatever? Anyway, I could imagine there being really interesting applicability for this conversation about what Creating the Future's website is about, and how a group of people who may or may not show up to participate with us directly, but who absolutely want to explore what it means to change the questions, and are highly motivated to do so. So maybe we could think our way as they being one group.
I just had a vision as this part of the conversation was going on, that you know how you have ambassadors to a place. I feel like what this site needs is ambassadors to the future. And you can have a whole yearbook-like or baseball card thing of ambassadors to the future, and you go through each door, and that ambassador introduces you to very future-thinking things.
Wow,
that's
very cool.
Such an adventure.
Love it.
Oh, my God.
Timestamp.
Yeah, I did that already. And I'm one of the things that I'm in the middle of writing, many of you may have already read the first half of the draft of our theory of change, and the second half that is still to be penned is the actual framework that we use. The catalytic framework that moves you from one place to another place and creates the future. And when you were talking about the paths, the steps to transparency, Janet, we already have a framework that is a flow. We already have, it's one of those sort of duh moments where you go, okay, so if the whole site is built around that flow,
that's right.
Mm-hmm. I'm also thinking about what you were talking about language before. The ambassadors to the future, those words, that language, what it does for making the fact that you can create the future real. Well, if there's an ambassador to the future, then there's a connection to the future that it's not, it's not just something that happens next. You know, the future is, I have no control of the future, whatever's going to happen. But when you start thinking about it from the perspective of there's a guide to that, well, there is a future that's out there that is, if not predictable, creatable, and here's someone who can help you create that. So that, it just really is resonating with me as a really powerful image that engages. I mean, immediately I ask questions. Well, what is that, an ambassador of the future? I'm already asking a question about it. I already want to know more just in thinking about it. So it does so many things.
And I think it's a way for you to engage your core users because they can, it'll be a mark of distinction. I want to be an ambassador to the future. And then you have, kind of an instant team of people that want this distinction. You manufacture desire and you kind of get curiosity from the people who haven't heard of you before.
You know, Janet, in the last meeting, several times it came up having a person, whether it's through office hours of, want to know how to use the site kind of thing. And this is really just pulling that all together. Mm-hmm. And from different places. So mm-hmm. If you've got ambassadors from the corporate world, you've got people who are immediately speaking your language and have put this into place. My brain's exploding, sorry.
Yeah, it feels very intentional. It's the intention piece that you have ambassadors who are there to guide you through the process. So you've got the process piece, which we were talking about in the flow, and the intentionality piece. Very cool.
Team, I apologize. I have to come off the line. It was such a pleasure to be with you. And I look forward to the notes I'm going to miss.
I'm so glad you were here, Carmen. Any reflections before you leave? Anything that's standing out for you, your own ahas?
I think I need some sugar because my brain is too overwhelmed, and I'm trying to just process some stuff. So I thought it was great. I think that you have a true set of, to coin our new term, ambassadors here on the phone, and it's just amazing work. It's going to be a lot of fun to see it come to shape.
Well, I'm glad you're part of it. Thank you for being here.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Bye.
Deep breath. It's also bringing us into the, we've talked about practice. We also talked about the fact that people would come to explore, to see what's going on, to see other people's success, to visualize what's possible, as we're looking at a place to explore, And Nancy talked, I'm sorry she's not here, about the feeling of exploring in a nice cozy library where you can go into nooks and crannies and stuff. I've seen websites that are fabulous in leading me someplace where an hour later I don't realize an hour has passed. And I've seen websites that have the exact same amount of stuff and I'm lost. Mm-hmm. What is it that makes me want to move from that next thing to that next thing?
Well, it's going to touch on the how a little bit, and I know we're not there yet. But part of it is visuals. It is about recognizing that some people process by reading, and they're more auditory, and just some people have limited attention. It's like they need a picture, they need a video, they need a graphic, they need some entry point that's clear to them. And actually, if you err on the side of what good design, the people who are readers are still going to get their needs met. So I think that's going to be really important.
I think some incentives are also good. Like, in Glass Pockets, we have the assessment tool, and for those that take and publicly share the assessment, we give them a badge for their website that says essentially we're a glass pocket foundation. So I don't know if there's something equivalent to that, or, you know, just like an online certificate kind of a thing, like you're officially a Center of the Future Futurist. Maybe there's certain milestones they have to do to get whatever the incentive is. But those things work really well, that carrot and not the stick approach.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
Mm-hmm. And that addresses that there's all kinds of different people who have all kinds of different motivations, mm-hmm. drives, levels of curiosity. I think I mentioned this to you previously when we first talked, Janet. The website is very clean. The Glass Pockets website. It is very easy to sort of figure out the different parts of it, because, as you said, it's very dense. I mean, there's a lot there. And yet, I don't feel intimidated when I come there. So that idea that, and this also addresses, Annette, what you were talking about in terms of graphically doing that. Mm-hmm. You know, how do you create something that is very open? And now we do the overlay of the ambassadors on top of that.
Is it what I'm looking at right there is... The one that's jumping out for me of all your boxes, Janet, is who has glass pockets?
Which is our call to action. And so right. I'm very happy to hear that.
And what I would want to know is, without any of the subtext under there, which I think I'm almost glad that I don't have my glasses on and can't see it, is that would intrigue me to press that button and find out.
Yeah.
That's the who else. Who else? Who else is playing here? How can I find my peeps?
Exactly.
Yeah.
And I think there's fun ways that you can use the ambassador as a thematic thing throughout the experience. So if you go the incentive model, you could have a passport to the future, and then there'll be different things you can do to get virtual stamps, but that might be too childlike, but you know what I mean.
Yeah. Well, what I'm picturing is just a button that says, who is creating the future?
Right.
You know, who else is creating the future?
And then there could be categories of the future. Like you had mentioned, there's the corporate part or, whatever your buckets are.
But also, I think regionally, because Gail mistakenly said something about Pennsylvania, talking about Justin, something that happened earlier, and right away it's like, oh, I would love to hear about who's excited about this in Pennsylvania, because I don't know. I mean, I spent most of my professional career in New Mexico. Mm-hmm. Very different climate, very different way of being.
I love that.
So I think regionally, too. Mm-hmm. But, one of the things, Janet, I'm reminded of when you talk about badges is, in the learning world, gamification is huge.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And it does appeal to a certain generation and also a certain personality. Mm-hmm. I have seen it done very well where the level to entry is low, so where you don't have to be so competitive that you feel incompetent and you're just like, I can't do this. It's like, I don't want to do another whatever. But, if you get a stamp in your passport, if you go here or whatever, I mean, that could build on the ambassador theme, and yet it shows involvement, and it's fun. I mean, even I'm not competitive at all, but, there's certain things like audible.com they have all kinds of silly badges for, up all night reader or whatever. Which is like, that's a low bar of entry, okay?
Wow, I can get a
flashlight under the covers.
I visited our website at 2 in the morning.
There you go. Yeah.
I want to come back to the question of what would I need to see that would make me want to explore versus the stuff that makes me not want to explore.
Lists are great hooks. Like, I'm curious, what are the 10 habits of future-oriented leaders or something, along those lines? Like, what does your data tell you as you look at your ambassadors of the future? What commonalities do they share? And then I would click through that slideshow to know what those habits are.
Yeah, I could see each one of those habits having more info on that or move to the next one?
And I like the thought of hooks. So that the habits is one, the who else is doing this is one. So the hooks are actually questions will lead us into want to explore, and a whole lot of answers won't. We're back to that.
Yep.
We're back to that, that the questions will make us want to explore and not... What else? What else leads you to want to explore when you get to a site?
I'm very visual. Infographic. Like I'm looking at the Path to Transparency infographic, which is lovely, on a GrantCraft website, which I got to from the Glass Pockets website.
Yeah. We partnered with them on a transparency guide, and you know, we're fond of that infographic quite a bit because it answers that question of what do I do next.
Yep. Yep. And it's a fun way of displaying it.
Yeah, what's popping for me is in all the places that we go, including our current website, that labels the destination rather than asking a question. So a button that says library, a button that says class, a button that says that we label the destination rather, which is coming from the us perspective, rather than identifying with the thing that people are looking for.
Yep. The volunteer center where I used to work used a wonderful approach on their website of, you know, three really basic pieces of searching. I want to learn, or I want to volunteer. I have a volunteer opportunity, and I'm looking for a volunteer. So it focused on who the user was rather than what we had to share with them, and it really did make it more effective.
Yeah.
I'm wondering.
So we're getting into the how. Is that what I'm hearing?
No, I'm just sort of playing with what do I need to feel and see when I get there? Mm-hmm. I need to feel invited. What is that going to look like, et cetera? Justin, go ahead.
Couple things that are jumping out at me, and some of this goes back to something that Janet said earlier about kind of overwhelming data, and you know, thinking about poking around, and it is not uncommon to come to a website and feel lost.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Which is exactly what we don't want. And right. It's either I have to keep digging and digging and digging, or keep clicking and clicking and clicking, like you show me one thing at a time, and so I'm not getting the full picture up front of what's going on, or you've just taken me somewhere that the context has totally changed from where I came there. And so I'm trying to think of sort of the flip side of that, but sense of place and context. And I actually think this is relevant to the creating a future framework, which is if you sort of don't know the context, at any given point, you could be like, well, why are we doing this?
Yeah.
why am I here? And so there's something about that continuity of experience, continuity of context, that as we're thinking, because I know we're coming up with lots of different things, but there's something that has to be able to unify that back, whether it is something that frames that curiosity or frames that inquiry or sort of keeps the focus on questions or something that we know is common across all of the experiences, all the places you might travel to, all the things you might start doing with us. And again, I don't know exactly what that looks like. It's just the feeling of lost is the feeling we don't want.
You know, Janet, you mentioned before that, and I agreed with you, that the first place you'll click after you click someplace is the about.
Mm-hmm.
In the olden days of the web, and you really don't find it a lot now, and I frequently find I'm missing it, people used to put a web map up.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yes.
And you don't see it anymore, and it's a place that I used to go a lot.
Yeah. Which,
okay, I'm here, I'm finding some stuff, but I need, Justin, you said context. I need context. Where am I in the scheme of things? I think that's a very, very simple, I need to know all that's here. Sometimes I don't, and sometimes I do, but I think that giving people mm-hmm. that sense of where the hell am I in the scheme of things here, sometimes it's something simple.
That may be a case where a scale map is a good analogy, because I'm thinking of a mall where it says, you are here.
Yeah.
A larger architecture, and so there might be a way to do a site map 2.0 at critical mm-hmm. structure, so people can see where they are in the context of the bigger picture.
Yeah.
Yeah, Jen, I was thinking about it from the perspective of if this is a dynamic site that is modifying and changing as you are
right.
Providing input to it, what does that mean for a sitemap? Mm-hmm. I mean, it's all doable. It's just a sitemap becomes your sitemap as opposed to everybody else's sitemap. The other thought that from the, inviting, pull you in, and whatever that I've been thinking about is, when we started talking about this, we were talking about our online presence, not just website, but our overall online presence. So does this also provide opportunities for lack of a better example, a Facebook type of place that's part of it as well? So that there is real-time, I found my peeps. Well, okay, great. These are my peeps. I want to be in conversation with those people that have the ahas. I want to have a more real-time conversation. It also, I'm also thinking about in the technology world, the idea of push and pull. That this is all pull right now. You come to the website, you pull what you want, you do whatever. But I can say, but I also want to be told or informed when something happens. When people are talking about this topic, whatever. So, right now, we use Twitter for, and by the way, speaking of Twitter, if you are watching, please let us know. We'd love to say hello to you. So use the hashtag CTFuture, end of commercial. But use these tools, and I think that expands the welcoming of it, because it makes it more than just a static site that you went to. It becomes part of an ongoing conversation.
Well, the other really cool thing, excuse me, is that we actually already have some pretty interesting interactive spaces, the Twitter chat and the Creating the Future Facebook page for consultants, excuse me, that are really great examples of the very things that we're describing here for the website. And, it would be really nice for people to know that those things exist, and whatever other tools or spaces are created so that they have a direct link to those from the website. That's really important. My other thought is one of the things that really stuck out for me early on about how Creating the Future used Twitter was you did it in such an engaging way by using it for conversation, asking questions, polling people, and seeking their input. Now, I can hardly stand looking at Twitter because it's all push, 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 all information all the time and absolutely no engagement. So I rarely go there anymore.
Yeah, same here.
Well, Twitter changed. And mm-hmm. the fact that we're longing for the good old days of 2008 is just, makes my head want to explode. So,
well, it's an opportunity for somebody else to create that platform.
Mm-hmm. But the other thing that I think is good about potentially making it more of a social platform is that in my world of child welfare, very few people in my world were active on, they certainly were not really a doctor. And some of them aren't even very active on Facebook or Twitter. They're not even on Twitter. Mm-hmm. A lot of it because of confidentiality reasons and so on, but they are on listservs, for example. Mm-hmm. Enough said. Yeah. And so I think having a space for them would be helpful.
Mm-hmm. I want to ask on a different place, because we've talked about exploring as just that generic sort of, if I want to explore, what will lead me there. We also talked about the fact that people will want to come to the site to see what's going on specifically with Creating the Future. Mm-hmm. That if we are going to be an ongoing demonstration project, there are people who are going to want to be tracking our progress, seeing what's going on, seeing what the success is. What would people need to see, experience, feel, to have them when they get there go, okay, yeah, this is exactly what I want. What would they need to feel and experience and see?
I only want to say one tiny thing about this, and that is I think they would need to see how Creating the Future is achieving not Creating the Future's mission, but their mission. I think that's really important.
Mm-hmm. Give me more. Anybody. It doesn't have to be you.
Okay.
I think that fundamentally goes to the experience is about them, not us.
Right.
They are experiencing our website. They are coming and bringing themselves to this thing. And just like you said earlier, Hildy, about not setting the destination, we also don't want to make it about us. We don't want them, and I think that's going way back to some of those complaints about the websites that throw up things in front of you.
Right.
What are all those things? It's all about them. Mm-hmm. Never about us.
Yeah, but if somebody is coming to see how we are doing, so let's say, let's come up with a million different, there could be somebody that is a mid-level manager someplace that just wants to make the case to their organization that something Creating the Future is doing. They've heard about it and they want to institute that, so they want to be able to track how are we doing with that and what are we learning so that it can impact them, or a foundation that may want to be partnering with us to say, who the hell are these guys and are they for real and are they really accomplishing what they say they're accomplishing, should I partner with them in terms of credibility? So there are people who are, it is going to be for them about us. How do we make that connection? What do they need to see and stuff to be able to say, oh, okay, and this is how that relates to me.
Yes, that's the piece I heard Gail talking about is how is this what do I see that tells me this is relevant to me? That what you're doing here is like what I'm trying to do here, and how do those two connect? Is that what you're talking about, Gail?
Well, I think of my time with an organization that I so desperately wanted to engage in this approach. And I knew that in many cases I was the champion because it made sense to me. And so it was important that I was able to show or feel represented by what Creating the Future was doing to my peers and colleagues. I'm not sure. I'm losing the ability to describe this well, but I can just say in response that I guess we're talking about people who feel and adopt and experience what Creating the Future is doing as their own, and then they sharing it out to the rest of the whoever they're sharing it with. And the more we can create something where they experience themselves in the description, no matter how much of it is Creating the Future, I think that's the degree to which we will be successful in our mission.
I came up with a question that may help us. What will it take for me to connect what Creating the Future is doing to why I care about what Creating the Future is doing? There's a reason I care about what Creating the Future is doing. And there may be a million different reasons, or seven different reasons, why I care about what Creating the Future is doing. I could be a foundation. I could be a. I could be somebody, a potential partner. I could be somebody who's learning, who's watching, and wants to see success. How do we connect showing what we're doing with the reasons people want to know why we're doing? So that it's not about what we want to show, but it's about why they care. Does that help any?
Yeah.
Because there's reasons they want to know.
You know, what's the for me question, right?
Yeah.
What was that, Janet? I'm sorry?
The what's in it for me question.
Oh, yes.
Right, what's in it for me to know what Creating the Future is doing?
Yeah, I mean, there is the dual role here of being a laboratory.
Right.
And demonstration. I think it's very important that you know that we're being an example, so that there does need to be some form of. I mean, I was picturing it almost like a, you know, like a newspaper site, you know, that. But it has to be in all of this context, you know.
So then, what I would need to see is So if I'm going to take an action. And I think we're all just sort of stuck on this one, so we're going to just keep playing with it. If I want to take an action, whether it is partner with Creating the Future or take what they've learned and ask my boss, no, this really makes sense, I would need to see proof, success stories, evidence in language that will... So for some people, evidence is stories, and for some people, evidence is data. I'm going to need to see it in a way that that I can then use it. So
yes,
that's and yes. I need to be able to find it. So find it in a way that I can use it for whatever the reasons are that I would be using it.
That really speaks to a lot of the issues that have come up over the years. Even with the fellows, about how do I translate the process I've learned into language that the organization I'm working with can understand.
So how can I find it, the evidence, the success, in a way that I can use it for whatever reasons I have for using it? So that would require our knowing the reasons, which again requires asking them. Mm-hmm.
Which changes the news they see.
Right.
Yeah, it's almost like a newspaper that has the sports section and the lifestyle section and the, you know, the home and garden section and the U.S. news and the world news. You know, depending on the questions you're answering, that's the section you get to see or that you want to see. You know, get to see is on our side, but that's the news you want is things that are applicable to why you're looking for it. Mm-hmm.
It is becoming, I'm sensing, I'm guessing you guys are sensing, but that's just because I'm assuming that you're thinking what I'm thinking, that we're hearing so much repetition of the same answers to different questions that we're getting very, very close to what does the design of this site need to incorporate. Feeling the how coming, the actions coming. So pulling the results of these three meetings together to then move into the how. Am I jumping the gun here? Are you guys feeling this?
Mm-hmm.
Jeez, I love it the way this works all the time. For those of you who have not experienced this process, we start out with what feels to some like big and airy fairy and oh, that's too visionary, too Pollyanna, and We always say, just wait for it, because the how will make itself known, and it is so making itself known. It's like we cannot resist the how at this point. I'm going to leave this entirely up to you guys in terms of what's next in terms of this session or next sessions, or are we like ready to take a deep breath on establishing the conditions that need to be in place and start looking at actual what design approaches would accomplish those conditions.
If we had a simple summary of some of the outcomes of the first two these three conversations, that would inform us as the basis of a conversation about the how. Perhaps the idea that came up earlier about examining and exploring some model websites that we feel are really valuable, although probably any website would give us some clues. And
And Robert also mentioned I loved his analysis of that as he was signing off last time, saying that we were ensuring that this web presence was going to be infused with creating the future's values and process. And almost offhandedly said, and it's 2015. All that stuff is doable. It's all out there. And I loved that comment that it's no longer, oh, God, we've got to invent it. It's like, no, it's out there. There's people doing this.
I think the what's in it for me question is really important, but I do agree that I think looking at peer websites in particular might help us tackle that, because we can see how others address that nut. And along those lines, I'm curious if there are, because as I'm hearing you talk, I'm thinking, oh, maybe I'll go look at a Bridgespan or a McKinsey for the coaching piece of this. And so do you have any suggestions or directions for us as far as who you consider your peers to be, so that we can look at what their frameworks are for some of these questions?
My initial response is that there are peers in a whole bunch of different categories, and there's so many different functions that we have also talked about. So I would love us to all be brainstorming that question, because I think that's a really powerful question. Who's already doing this piece of what we're doing and this piece of what we're doing? And what will be interesting, Janet, I think, is that I think it's going to come from places that we're not expecting it. I think that where we might see, oh, okay, what are our peers and what we're doing, but there's other people who want to accomplish this same thing and are doing it by, you know, selling peas in China. I mean, I don't know.
Right, and well, maybe not doing what you're doing, but a couple of things come to mind, like maybe reaching the same audiences you want to reach, or trying to change behavior in some of the same audiences you're trying to change it in, so that, again, we can map to certain frameworks that are working for change orientation, even though we know their mission is completely different from yours. But I think that would help us steer us in a direction that gets us closer to answering the what's in it for me question.
Mm-hmm. Right. Right, and I'm looking at also how are people answering the what's in it for me question. So I would love to see us come up with a range of sites that are sort of common to the work that we're doing at that meta capacity building level, and then even deeper in. Also looking at what are sites that each of us go to that have pieces of the functionality that we're talking about.
And I think it's important, probably, maybe from my own perspective, I've almost always had to go outside of my bubble to get inspired, because I tend to be a little delayed in jumping on board with exciting stuff in my world. And so a lot of my inspiration has come outside of the nonprofit sector.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, I think that's important to keep in mind, too.
Yeah.
Well, and I think, I'm sorry, go ahead. I think in the last session, both Troy and Robert said, you know, immediately there were sites that came to mind that are doing pieces of this that we might not be familiar with at all, but immediately they said, ooh, you know, I thought about such and such. Troy brought up a tech site a couple of times that totally different topic, but the way they structure the invitation and how people interact, there may be some of those pieces, as you're saying, in that are totally outside of our everyday interactions that might lend themselves very well to thinking outside the box.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, the other thought that never occurred to me, but that Carmen brought up, is that many of the functions that we are looking to accomplish are frequently accomplished on intranets.
Yes.
That we wouldn't necessarily see, because that functionality of practice and co-supporting each other and et cetera aren't typical of external sites, but are often very typical of internal sites. And that's huge. Go ahead, Annette.
Well, and I think intranets, perhaps, that are not necessarily being used in nonprofits.
Right, right.
Because they don't have the funding for a really well-designed, very, very well-developed intranet.
Which is why Carmen is talking about having a dynamic one in an insurance company that insures, you know, not Jay Leno's cars.
Right.
Anybody but Jay Leno's cars, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, okay. I'm gonna ask us to take a deep breath and take a look at any notes you may have taken during this wild and wacky hour and a half together, and just a moment of reflection on what is standing out for you. What are your ahas from our time together today?
I'm excited to think of the future in terms of geography and think of it as a physical place instead of just a time continuum.
That's beautiful.
Mm-hmm. And a physical place where you can travel from place to place like other wonderful.
Yeah. You know? Oh, that's beautiful.
Yeah, I want to learn good culture, I want a vacation there, you know, figure out what
to play
there.
It's great. It's great. Oh, I love it. I love it.
So we can set up, like, some hotels there.
We can set up, let's say, the restaurant at the end of the universe.
Yeah, exactly.
Mm-hmm. Well, we know that.
We explore the outside of it.
I love it. Ah. What else is aha-ing for you guys today?
I am actually looking. I googled behavioral change websites just for fun, and found something called Do Something Different, which is actually quite a beautiful little piece of website in terms of what we're thinking about. Anyway, and what it made me think about was how much of this conversation is about normalizing. In capital letters, normalizing what it means to change practice, to change things, and how exciting it is to embark on the journey of being with people to do that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Including myself.
Yeah. Nancy, Annette, Dimitri, what is popping for you guys?
I'm stuck on the ambassadors to the future.
Yeah, and the fun of the theme that's naturally rolling out through that, the traveling together, the, you know, the tour guide, the, you know, I mean, there's so many ways you can make that really exciting.
Mm-hmm.
So then we can have, like, the travel agent booth. You know,
right.
Why not?
Oh.
The TARDIS?
Yeah. I was behind a car today that had a bumper sticker that had a little TARDIS in it, and next to it says, much bigger on the inside.
Yes. 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 Yeah, I was looking at my notes and the things that I had starred, which are my timestamp kind of moments, and it did come back to the ambassadors to the future and the flow. So as soon as Janet talked about the stepping stones and Hildy said, we already have the process, I was like, that's a visual image in my brain that now I'm like, oh, now I know where we could go. And the door is opening and the ambassadors helping people get there. And I was like, okay, that summed up the 2 hours for me right there.
I'm excited about being able to convey these three sessions, the outcomes or the aha moments, to people who are skilled at the technology, so that they're excited and inspired. Because what so often happens is that, oh, we put together websites for nonprofits, which is, you know, the canned WordPress site, you know, that, you know, it'll have different colors and different pictures and different images, but it's pretty much the same for everybody. Mm-hmm. So, you know, you can do some with that. I'm not putting down that you can't do stuff with that, but I'm just intrigued with the idea of telling somebody, hey, think about this in a real different way. Just take your own restrictions off and just think about what's possible here in terms of doing this. So it's just...
And what brings to mind is something I was thinking about earlier, is that you need to break out design and development. Have them talk together, but they're two different functions. And developers sometimes have a really hard time coming up with the visuals of what that portal looks like, but they do know how to make it do that. And sometimes people have both skill sets, and sometimes they don't.
Thank you for that, because where my brain was going is that I live very comfortably in the world of the conversations we've just had. Okay. I have no clue on God's green earth how to take the flow of our process, the sense of questions, the spirit of energy and ambassadors, and I have no clue how to turn that into what it might be in a web presence. And it's actually making me uncomfortable. So it's real fun to watch where people flow in and out of their comfort zone and their places of wisdom, because where you're getting excited now of, oh, wow, okay, it would be great to watch, and Annette is going, okay, we separate out design and development, and it's like logically making sense to people who live in that A, how space, but also the web space, and I'm at the point of, I'm lost. Okay, I'm done. I have no clue, and yeah. So that's a pretty powerful observation for me in terms of my own self-reflection of me in this process. So
I'm wondering if this might be a project that intrigues IBM and get Watson as the person, as the entity that you
let Watson figure it out.
Let Watson figure it out.
Throw all this stuff into Watson, see, and he'll come up with the Jeopardy answers.
42, obviously.
Obviously.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that goes with the restaurant at the end of the universe.
Entirely. Entirely. Yep. Cool. Guys, thank you. This has been brilliant and wonderful and powerful, and this is going to kick ass. I don't know what the hell it's going to be, but it is totally going to kick ass.
Yeah, it's exciting.
And hopefully we will see you guys in a couple of weeks back here.
And next week, perhaps.
Sounds good.
And you, absolutely.
Yes,
next
week. Yeah.
Thanks, guys.
Bye-bye. Take care.
Bye.
Bye, everyone.
Bye.
Bye.